Hey guys, welcome to another episode of Kara Dangerous Live. It's actually the second episode of Kara Dangerous Live, another extension of Kara Dangerous Talk. Oh, tonight, you see I'm dressed up, baby. I'm in the mood. I'm in a soulful, funky, groovy mood. I have a great musician with us tonight. I'm going to give him a great interview, and then we're going to hear a song from him. It's going to be an amazing night. So before we get to it, you know what the deal is. Let's hit it.
It ain't the same around here like it used to be. You'll see people sit together like you used to see. I keep telling the people to find inner peace. Don't pull out that gun.
All right, here we go. Here we go, brother. What's going on, Mr. Marcus Machado?
What's going on? How you doing?
I'm good. How about yourself?
I'm good. Can't complain. Thanks for having me on your show.
Oh, no problem. Look, you know what, Marcus? I don't know if you're the only child prodigy I spoke to, but I'm so hyped up about that. Now, why you had to be better than the rest of us and just pop out of the womb and just be amazing right out the womb? Like, come on, man.
Come on. It ain't me.
Wait, am I lying? Did Rolling Stone not write a story about you being a child prodigy? Am I wrong about that?
No, you're right. Can't complain. But thank you.
When a child is 2 years old, I mean, I think all I know that they can do is pretty much say Google Gaga, scream, right. Cry, you know, drink milk. But were you really playing a guitar at 2 years old? How can it be?
Yes, it was. Yeah, I mean, for my mom, she told me, you know, when she was pregnant with me, that anytime that she would play music, I would always kick her stomach. You know what I mean? So it was straight, really, literally out the womb. And, you know, my father, he was a musician, so the guitar was laying around the house. And I remember 2 years old, just picking it up and start fiddling around with it. And from there, I've been playing ever since. You know, professionally, I've been playing since nine, but I picked it up at two. Yeah.
So I know your parents inspired you. So you're in the belly, you know, you're kicking your mom. She's saying, ouch, ouch. You come out her belly and just start playing music. What kind of music were your parents playing around the house? Because I know you just answered that a little bit, but I know your mom had extensive record collection.
What were
you grabbing out of her collection? Because I know you were snooping.
Yeah, oh, for sure. I mean, around the house, there was so many different genres of music. And that's why in my music, you hear a little bit of everything. But yeah, my mom, she wasn't a musician, but her ear for music was Earth, Wind & Fire, John Coltrane, to Kool & the Gang, to P-Funk, to Joni Mitchell, you know what I mean, to Miles Davis, to Weather Report. And then, you know, on my father's side, you know, it was all rock. So it was like Led Zeppelin, Jimi Hendrix, Black Sabbath. So both of my parents' collection was, you know, crazy. So that's all I was doing, is just going through the records and just playing all this type of music, you know what I mean? But what gravitated to me the most was Jimi Hendrix. I mean, as far as I can remember, the first thing of me listening to anything as a kid that I can remember was the Jimi Hendrix album. That was Electric Ladyland. Yeah, that was like the first thing that caught my eye that I can remember, you know.
It's funny because we'll get into it, but when I was listening to your album, you know, I hear Jimi Hendrix. I mean, I hear him in there.
Yeah.
And it's something about you. I was listening to your music and I'm like, what style is he? I mean, it's like you can do any style.
Right. Thank you. I mean, for me, it's just gravitating to all different genres of music. And, you know, once I got a little bit older, you know, I have like seven siblings. So I had older brothers and, you know, younger sisters and stuff. So my older brother was, you know, hip hop head. So everything from Tribe Called Quest, KRS-One, you know, he's from the 90s. So, you know, I had all of that. And then, you know, of course, my generation was like, you know, D'Angelo, Slum Village, Jay Dilla, all of that. So you had all of that. And then plus, like, of course, Prince and, you know, Eddie Hazel, and just me just being just like a sponge, just soaking up everything. And, you know, when it came down to me making my own music, I didn't want to be in a box, you know, so to say, you know what I mean? Especially as a black guitar player, because, you know, coming up, you know, it was like if you played guitar, either you were a church guy, or heavy metal. There wasn't no in between. So they try to like put you in the box. And for me, I didn't want that. You know, I listen to everything. You know, as much as I love D'Angelo, it's the same as much as I love Prince. So for me, it was like when it came down to my music, I was like, I don't want to be in no box, no genre. You know what I mean? Make people think that maybe I hear a little bit of rock or I hear a little bit of funk and jazz and try to put all of that together. It's like a gumbo, you know?
I love that. I absolutely love that. You know, be style, like be without a style, flow like water, like Bruce Lee said.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. Now, when you were a child, I want to know this because I played piano lessons. Well, I was in piano lessons for over 10 years. I played piano for 10 years.
Okay.
And my niece right now is taking piano lessons. And the teacher's been, you know, just raving about how she learns quickly. But did you ever go through periods, even though you were a child prodigy, where, you know, you just didn't put the work into your music like you needed to? Or did you stay pretty focused throughout?
I would say I'd stay pretty much focused. I mean, for me, it was like, that's all I knew. I mean, of course, I love sports and, you know, I was basketball. I played ball in school and, you know, track and all that. But for me, it was always music. You know what I mean? So my mom, she made a pact with me. She was like, you know, I'll get you shows and stuff like, you know, because I wanted to go out and play. I didn't want to be cooped up in the room. So she was like, listen, you know, you get good grades, then I'll help, you know, I'll be there with you, you know, for shows. And, you know, from 9 years old, you know, I was playing in clubs at nine. So for me, she was like, you know, as long as I got good grades, I'll be able to like play, you know, shows. So that was my thing. It's like to get out and play in front of people. But I don't think for me, I never had a, you know, to where I was never forced or, you know, I didn't never feel like the energy to practice. For me, it's always was trying to get better. You know what I mean? And then, you know, at 9 years old, then I start playing different instruments. So, you know, I start gravitating to the bass, the drums, you know, piano and all that too. So for me, it was like, you know, once I picked up the guitar at two, I just kind of just took off with it and just try to get better, you know?
Well, just express to me, how do you feel when you play? Because growing up, I was also in the marching band. And when we would have our concerts, I mean, I wasn't the best saxophone player, but I did what I can do. But right. You know, I also would listen to music around the house when my mom would play classical music and whatnot. But right. being a part of that band, man, I just felt like I could fly. I just felt so free when I would feel like I was a part of that sound.
Yep.
How do you feel? Because obviously you connected with music right away. Mm-hmm. So give us a little insight into your mind when you're a part of that musical moment.
I mean, for me, it was always, you know, just being on stage and playing. It's just, you know, you express yourself so many different ways, you know what I mean? And with music and just playing, it's just free. You know what I mean? You can do whatever you want and you feel like you're unstoppable. You know, you can do whatever it is. You know what I mean? Doesn't matter. And for me, I always the idea was to, you know, as much as I play in a room when there's nobody, think of that same energy is in front of 10,000 people, 5,000 people. But always take your mind to where, you know, you're just in the room. So I always brought that approach, you know what I mean? Because, you know, sometimes you can get a little nervous, you know, depending on, you know, where you're at in your career. But for me, I always try to just be free and just be yourself. You know what I mean? I feel like the greatest tool is just be yourself. You know what I mean? And if you have something, it will find you. You know what I mean? So it's just like as much work you put into it, it's going to reward you in many ways that you never could imagine. You know what I mean? So that was always me, just being free and just, you know, it just takes you somewhere, you know what I mean? Even just learning different songs and stuff, like at one time I would practice at least 3-4 hours a day, you know what I mean? After school, just straight, you know, just play, sit in my room, learn stuff. And, you know, even to this day now, you know, of course we're busy, we got bills to pay and all that, but
right.
You know what I mean? I try to always take that approach. It's like going to the gym. It's like a sport, you know what I mean? You always want to get better. And, you know, a person always told me, like, never get too comfortable because there's always a person in front of you and there's a person behind you. So never get too big headed. You know, doesn't matter if you played in that marching band or, you know, you played all around the world. You know what I mean? Always stay humble and always try to get better. And that's what I try to do. I've been playing all my life, but, you know, with the guitar, this instrument is just like there's so many things to learn. So I don't never feel like I could be as top of where I want to be, but the only thing I can do is just get better. And, you know, all that stuff is just traveling around the world and just, you know, just try to get better, you know?
Now, I heard a story that someone asked you to go on tour with them, Yeah. And you had 2 weeks to learn 30 songs. And then you show up there, and then there's literally no rehearsal.
Yep.
Now,
very true.
Were you freaking out? How prepared were you?
Of course. I mean, shout out to an RIP to, you know, the great legendary Victor Bailey. You know, rest in peace. You know, he was the bass player for Weather Report. So for people that don't know, Jaco Pastorius, the world's greatest bass player, he took his place when he left Weather Report. And Victor Bailey, he played with Sting, Madonna, so many different people. And, you know, it's a great, giant, legendary bass player. And, I was doing the show with the Family Stand here in New York. This was like years ago. And he was sitting right there the whole time. I did not realize it was Victor Bailey. And this is a guy that I had all his records. You know what I mean? So as a kid playing bass, I learned all the stuff. But in person, I didn't realize this was the same guy. So he went after the first show, came up to me. He's like, I like your playing. Take my car and call me tomorrow. And, you know, in passing, you know, there's a lot of stuff going on. So, you know, respectful, you know, thank you. And that's it. And then it wasn't until when I got home and I looked at the car and I was like, wow, this is Victor Bailey for real. And then I called him the next day. I was like, Victor, he was like, yeah, man, I've been waiting for you to call. You know, we're going on tour. I want you to come out to, you know, Italy. And, you know, at first it was like a week. And then he said, you know, it's going to be 2 weeks. And, you know, I just want you to be a part of this stuff. Can you clear your schedule? I was like, of course. Hell yeah, I'll clear my schedule. I've never been to Italy. And I was like, okay, so what's the songs? And he's like, oh, I'll send it to you. And every time, you're talking about maybe 3 months, you know, prior to the gig. So I had a way long in advance to learn this music. Mm-hmm. And up to like that day before leaving out of New York to go to Italy, I had no songs. You know, he was just giving me just multiple songs. And you're right, it was 30 songs. And I had all these songs in my head. And then not know a set list, what was going to play. And it wasn't until when we got to the actual venue, the same day as we arrived, he's like, yeah, sound check is at 6. And we get in front of this dome, and it's like at least, like, I think it was like maybe 5,000-10,000 people. Still did not know what song that we're playing. And, got on stage, and the band, because the rest of the musicians that played with him, you know, they play with them sometimes. I was like the first guy to kind of play with them. So I was kind of like the rookie in this scenario. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they think like, oh, we're going to play the same songs. And he turns to me and he's like, no, we're going to do these songs. And you had to learn on the spot. You know what I mean? So for me, I always took that as never get too comfortable. And, you know, because it can either break you or make you, you know, tougher. You know what I mean? And absolutely. I made it through the gig, thankfully. And, you know, he told me that the reason why that he did that, because he knew that I would take it seriously and I would always, you know, bring my A game to it. Whereas musicians, you know, they tour a lot and they play with different artists, so they get comfortable. So they feel like they don't need to put in the work and, you know, learn the songs, and they kind of play lazy. You know what I mean? So that's why that he did that. But man, that was a crazy gig, but we made it through, you know?
Yes, very dedicated. Yes. So you also, you said earlier that Jimi Hendrix is one of your, I'm going to use the word guitar heroes.
Yeah.
But you didn't tell us a couple of years back, you actually was able to go to his home. Is that correct?
Yeah.
And you play in his home. Tell us about that experience.
Oh, man, that was crazy. You know, at the time I was living in Amsterdam. And this was like back in 2017, 2016. And they re-put up his apartment where he stayed at. So everything is pretty much how the way it was. And they never really had nobody played in there. So, you know, I called up people. I was like, man, this would be amazing if I can just go in there and just play. And everything worked out in my favor and went out there. And it was, you know, very spiritual, you know, crazy experience to actually sit on the bed, you know, lyrics, everything, his records, clothes, all that stuff was in the same place how the way they left it. So it was almost like a museum. And yeah, that was a great experience. That was handling Hendrix.
Absolutely. What we kind of went over a little bit, some challenges about going on tour, but for the people who dreaming of being a tour musician, and I know you're a tour and a studio musician, what's some of the biggest challenges besides what we just talked about being a musician that's always on the road?
Oh man, it's just being adapting to not getting no sleep, you know, not eating good, you know, Lobby Call. You know, I think this was 2019, right before the pandemic. I was out on tour with Jose James. Shout out to Jose. And, you know, our schedule was like, we was taking almost 2 to 3 airplanes a day. You know what I mean? And Lobby Call was like 6 a.m., you know what I mean? So we would get into the city, to that city, like around 2-3 o'clock, drop your bags off, go to sound check, eat something real quick, change clothes. It's like maybe 8-9 o'clock, you do the show. By the time you get to the hotel and chill, it's like maybe 1-1 o'clock. And then you got to turn around and do that for 2 months. So, you know, I mean, as a traveling musician, you know, it's a lot of hard labor. You know what I mean? Especially if you don't like to fly, and you know, now during the pandemic, now you got germs and all this different stuff. But yeah, it's very hard. It's very hard. And then, you know, session musician is just it's just playing different music. You know what I mean? You know, for me, I always wanted to play music that I like. You know what I mean? Not to be too picky. So, you know, a lot of musicians, you can learn a piece of music and you don't really like it, and you gotta put yourself into that music. But for me, I try to surround myself with things that I really like, and you know, music that I can put my energy towards. So I think that would probably be the hardest thing, is just, you know, just staying, you know, busy, and just kind of really just training yourself for the road, because it's not for everybody.
I would say, I've heard that before. But trust me, I've definitely heard that before.
A lot of people, they think like, oh, you go to Paris or you go to these different cities and you can actually walk around and sightsee and buy clothes. And that's not the vibe. Usually when you get to the city, you're really tired and you just want to sleep. And then you get to some of these cities and the food is trash, you know. And you're kind of like, okay, the only thing that's open is McDonald's, you know. So I don't know what you're going to do.
They always got a McDonald's, right, on every block.
Yeah, every block. But the only thing that I would say, Europe McDonald's versus U.S. McDonald's, the fries are crispy. So it looked like the commercial. So, you know, I don't know about the burger, but the fries I can do, you know.
You get those fries hot. They good now. That's the best thing on the menu.
Yeah, right.
Look, I know different brands of guitars have their own unique sound, which is amazing. But I find it fascinating that you design your own guitars, mm-hmm. and you have endorsement deals. Yeah. Where can we pick up one of your guitars? Let us know.
My guitars, well, actually, I started my line, that was back in 2017, 2018, and I was just doing like limited guitars. So like, maybe 5 guitars at a time. But you know, now with me being so busy on the road, it's like I need to find a distributor, somebody that can make these models. So I'm kind of working on that, getting back into the swing of, you know, getting back to selling my own custom guitars. So look out for that. You could probably stay on my website and check all that stuff out. In the meantime, I have D'Angelico guitars right here, Black Gypsy. See this guitar here?
Yes, nice.
Yeah, so shout out to D'Angelico. I've been using these guitars for the past couple of years now. Before that, you know, I was always a Fender Strat guy. So that's what Jimi Hendrix, a lot of different people use Strats. You know, that's like one of the main, it's like Nike, you know what I mean? Like Nike or Adidas is one of the big name brands. But D'Angelico, I always wanted to find a guitar that I can get different tones and different sounds out of it. And yeah, I've been using these guitars for a couple of years and I love it. So I have a couple different, you know, guitars and stuff. So this one, I like to name my guitar, so it's Black Gypsy, you know.
Black Gypsy, okay. Yeah, I was wondering like what makes a guitar design better than another? Like what did you have made about that design that was customizable for you that you really like?
Yeah, I think for me, like with this guitar, for example, like you see this right here, it's a maple neck. So a maple neck is more tone-wise, it's more bright, you know. Mm-hmm. And I have another guitar that has a dark neck, which is like rosewood. So that gives you more of a darker sound. You know, it's like cars, you know what I mean? Each guitar has a different tone, a different vibe to it. So you know,
that's what I know it may sound silly, but I never thought about that.
Yeah, that's what it is. A lot of people think like, oh, you just got, you know, all these different guitars and they all sound the same, but they don't. No, no. He's guitar.
So, okay, so that's dope to know. So next time I go into a guitar center or something, I see all these different shapes of guitars and different looks. They actually got their own thing going on.
Their own thing. It's like a car or a watch or a hat. It's got its own flavor to it, you know?
That actually makes me excited.
Yeah. Check it out.
Let me ask you a question, Marcus. How did you get your mom to buy you an electric guitar? Because I asked my mom for a guitar. Oh. My mom bought me this.
She gave you the flamingo guitar. She gave you the knees. You lost strings. Look. But you still got it, though, right?
I still got it. I probably learned 10 little Indians and put it down. Once my fingers were hurting, I said, you know what? Forget it.
For me, I mean, I really saved up my money. Like, I got my own actual guitar with, like, my own money from doing shows. You know what I mean? So that was a thing where you had layaway, you know, music stores. I don't have that no more. You know, I would go to the music store and look in the window every day and, like, play. And I would put $5, $20 at a time. And, you know, back then, guitars was maybe like, I don't know, $500. Now guitars are way too expensive. You know what I mean? So just for an average kid, it's like having a MacBook. Like, you got to spend about $1,300 just to get a decent guitar. But yeah, me, I was all layaway. I was had my money saved. My mom would help. You know, she'd be like, I'll give you $100 here and there. But that's how I started getting my first actual own guitar, which was a white Strat. Yeah.
Well, what is it? Do you age out? Like, am I too old to, like, really learn how to play well?
Nah, not at all. There's no age limit to playing any instrument. Like, right now, the only thing that I would say, if you want to pick up the guitar or the piano or whatever it is just, like, you just got to put work. You just got to put time into it. You know what I mean? Because that same guitar could be sitting there right in the corner looking at you, but if you don't pick it up and play, you know, it ain't gonna do nothing for you, so you know.
Now, if I learn how to play this thing, I'm gonna want to start a band.
Go ahead, do it.
Well, I'm gonna be like that football player, that country singer. You're in my band, but you have no idea.
I have no idea what you got yourself into. Yeah.
You have no idea you're in my band, but I'm calling on you, Marcus. Come on.
I got you.
Like, I'm changing my number. Look, you get to work with so many great artists, like contemporary artists, Anderson .Paak, like, mm-hmm. Oh my God, Pat.
Yeah.
How did you hook up with them? They're like the biggest band right now, besides Channel 13. So
yeah, no, shout out to AT. I met him through a mutual friend that was a couple years ago. Shout out to D Prosper. And actually, this was like right before Pac got really big. So this is like Malibu, you know, time. And he came out to New York. He did his first show at SOB's, a club out here in New York called SOB's. And I ended up opening up for, you know, Anderson. And from there, this was like 2016, 2017. And yeah, we've just been close, you know what I mean? So I've seen his progression going up. And now he's an A-list. He's an A-list artist, you know what I mean? So
yes.
It's good to see. It's good to see, you know, the fam blowing up and doing that. But really cool dude, you know?
Are you where you want to be in your career? I mean, I know that's one of those questions, you know.
I mean, for us as creatives, and you know, doesn't have to be a musician. I mean, just being a creative, you always set the bar high. And once you accomplish something, you go to the next. So for me, you know, I'm totally grateful and honored of, you know, so many things that I've accomplished. But for me, I always set the bar so high. Me personally, I can never think that I can get to where I want to be. Even if I had 20 Grammys and all this different other stuff, I'm still going to want to keep reaching for more. So for me, it's like, I want to be the goal. If I had one goal, I would like to be like B.B. King, a buddy.
Okay. Guy.
You know what I mean? I want to be old, 80, 90 years old, still playing the guitar. You know what I mean? If that's a goal, you know what I mean?
I love that. How do you keep up? Because you're in a band. I didn't even know you was in this band, to be honest with you. DMD, you, my buddy Daryl Jones, Grammy Award winner, Jack White from the White Stripes, Talib Kweli, and the bass player is Doug Wimbush from Living Color. That's amazing.
Yeah, Uncle D. Yeah. That's the fam. Like Doug Wimbush, Living Color, they Vernon Reed, they know me since I was like 14 years old. So that's like fam. That's like really, really fam. They've seen me from a kid growing up. So to be in a band with, you know, Uncle D, Doug, and Daru, my brother, you know, that's one big family affair. So, you know, we try to stay busy with a lot of different projects, you know.
You really like putting that hip hop in it, like mixing that hip hop.
Of course. Yes.
Of course.
You have to. You have to. For me, it's just putting something different to the table. You know what I mean? I just, like I said earlier, I don't want to limit it myself. You know what I mean? So whatever it is, it's like, if it's heavy guitars, you know, solo and all that, I got to have a heavy backbeat behind it. You know what I mean? So, and that creates a whole different sound, a different genre. Yeah.
Well, before we get to your latest album and we hear a song from your latest album, talk to me about the band Channel 13, because in Channel 13, we have my friend Darryl Jones, the excellent drummer, and we also have legendary hip-hop rapper Pharoah Monch. Yep. So you guys are really rocking out in there. It's hard for me. You guys say it's rock and hip hop, but it sounds a lot different. It has its own distinct thing going on.
Yeah.
What was the idea behind your band there with Channel 13?
With 13, you know, it was just bringing something really different to the table. You know, we've heard a lot of rock and hip hop bands. You know, you have Rage Against the Machine, Ice-T, Body Count, you know, which is really, really heavy metal. But with 13, we want to have a different approach because it's the three of us. So, for example, Pharoah Monch, you know, this is a guy that I've listened to since from a kid and had all his albums. So for me, I'm a fan, you know what I mean? And to be in a group with him, it's like saying like Doug Wimbush, was totally honored to be in the same situation as them. But like with 13, you know, if Monch is spitting all these crazy bars, and then it gets down to me to do the solo, he didn't want to like have me just do a little solo and then the song fades out. He's like, no, I want you to like, you do your verse. So it's like me answering him. And then with Daru, with, you know, his playing, it creates a different combination. And then the whole idea of 13 was, you know, all the wickedness that's going on in the world and, you know, bringing that into the light. And it's almost like a cleanse. You know what I mean? We need to cleanse ourselves from all the evil and wicked, you know, stuff that's going on in the world. So a lot of people, when they first saw it, the images and stuff with the mask, it was like, okay, what is this? It's nothing satanic, you know, Satan, nothing like that going on. It's just kind of like giving you a mirror to let you know, like, hey, this is what's going on, and pay attention to the music, you know what I mean? And draw people in. So that's the whole concept of, you know, Channel 13, you know, shout out to Monch and Daru, you know.
I would, you know, thank you for explaining that to us. And I think that band is awesome. And I would, you know, ask you to talk about our band next, but I haven't come up with a name.
Yeah, we got a record that we're working on that's coming out 2025, you know. It's called,
why is it going to take so long?
It's going to take some time. Flamingo Electric, you know, she's holding a flamingo guitar. I'm holding electric guitar. Flamingo.
I don't know if you remember, it was an episode of Family Matters, and Urkel kept saying, Flamingo!
We already got the look, you know, we got the Zorro look with the hat, you know what I'm saying? It's already
Flamingo.
There. Flamingo Electric, that's what we're going to call it. That's our new band. Right,
I promise I'm going to ask you about your album next, but I want to bring this up because I just think this is awesome. You actually was able to score a film.
Yeah.
Tell us about that, because you have your own production company with your sister, which I find fantastic as well, that you can work with one of your siblings. I know that's hard sometimes.
Shout out to your sis. You know, Vic, she has a new actual sample pack that came out today called Concrete Joker. So a sample pack is, she created 100 different sounds. So for producers and different artists, you can go pick that up, download it at sounds.com. But the movie score and stuff, you know, I really got into it by accident. There was a guy that reached out to me, shout out to Patrick House. And he reached out to me. He was like, man, I love your work. And, you know, I have this 20-minute, you know, documentary thing that I would love to do. And, you know, I love your project. At the time, this is before Aquarius Purple, I had 29, my EP out. And he was like, man, he was like, it's kind of like 70s, 60s vibe. And I would love for you to score. And I was like, I love scoring, you know, from watching movies. I always was very interested in how music goes to, you know, scenes and all that stuff. So, but I said, I don't know how to do it. So he just gave me kind of like, he's like, here's the scenes, add whatever you want to add to it. And I really got into it. And from that, spun on with me working with Robert Glasper. You know, shout out to Robert Glasper. And Robert Glasper, he brought me on to the big leagues, you know what I mean? So, you know, I was able to score with him, you know, the Apollo documentary, you know, that got an Emmy for that. And then Contact High, I ended up doing that with my sister. And then, you know, we did Mr. Soul, that's out right now. They got an NAACP Image Award. And from that, pretty much it really started with one. And that's what they always say, a lot of composers. They're like, once you do one, it just takes off from there. And that's totally different from playing live or, you know, being in the studio recording a project. You know, it's very particular of, you know, where the music must go, because, you know, you have your ideas that what you put to the scenes, and then you have a creative director that takes a look at it, and then sometimes they can change it up, and then it goes, it's a long process, you know what I mean? But overall, you know, I love it, you know what I mean? And you can do it from home. I don't have to be on the road. Mm-hmm. The checks are big, you know what I mean? So, you know, so that's always good, you know?
Well, I'm about to go, hey, Marcus.
Yeah. Go electric. You can actually score, you know?
Yes. That is awesome. Look, let's get right into it. Aquarius Purple. Okay. I'm feeling a lot of Prince from the cover. I was thinking that I was going to hear a lot of Prince on the album, but I heard more Jimi Hendrix, but you can tell me if I'm wrong, but a very nice album to listen to. I feel like not only can you just relax with your music, you can dance.
Thank you.
It's just a really nice vibe. You can have you a glass of wine.
Thank you.
You know, chillax.
What was
your vibe for your album that you released this year?
Oh man, so to kind of rewind back real quick was, you know, 13. I was working on that project. That took us about 6-7 years. And then Aquarius Purple, I started that in 2009. You know, when I was actually living in Amsterdam at the time. So a lot of these songs were in my travels. And, you know, during the pandemic, it really took the pandemic for me to finish it. You know what I mean? Because I always kept saying, oh, I'm going to put it out. And, you know, I would have to go on tour and something would always come up. And I didn't want to put out a lot of music and then it kind of gets lost. So my whole idea of Aquarius Purple was, you know, it's a homage to all my guitar heroes. So, you know, that's why you hear Prince, you hear Jimmy, Stevie Ray Vaughan, Eddie Hazel, a little bit of D'Angelo. It's all my influences that, you know, that I love and try to put it into one. And the Aquarius Purple, you know, I'm Aquarius, of course. And the purple is the colors of the whole album and the sounds of the guitar. So that's what the purple represents. It represents the music and that whole aspect of it. So that's what Aquarius Purple was. And, yeah, I'm super happy that everybody is, you know, feeling it and digging it. And, yeah, looking to do more music and more new albums is coming soon and stuff. But, yeah, Aquarius Purple, pick that up. You know, for me, if you do purchase it, please get the vinyl. You would like the vinyl better. You know what I mean?
Vinyl. Yeah, you put out the vinyl, and is it true it sold out in, like, 57 seconds?
Yeah, it did. It did.
Cause
because what we did was shout out to Soul Step Records. What I wanted to do with this project was I didn't want to do like what everybody else did and just put it on the streaming platforms. I really wanted to make it special. And with this being my debut album, it was kind of risky because I'm putting it out during the pandemic. Things is a little crazy, so I don't know what's going to happen. So what I did was I created about 100 different type of vinyl. So everything was like super psychedelic and it was like limited edition, and those sold out in 50 seconds. And I was overwhelmed with all the, you know, vinyl collectors and how much love people show, you know, for the album. And then I think 2 months later, because that came out in February, end of February, and then 2 months later in April, then I, you know, released the album digitally and stuff. But yeah, I'm super, you know, ecstatic and blessed to, you know, everybody's feeling the album. Because, you know, at that time, you know, I didn't know what was going to happen. You know what I mean? It was like one of those things, like, I don't know, Beyonce could put out the album the same week and it's a wrap. You know?
Right, right.
Then people would be like, did you have an album? You're like, yeah, but it came out like 2 years ago. You know what I mean? So I feel like, you know, even with 13, those two projects, the timing was really perfect, you know, how the way it came out. So, you know, it's one of those things, like how I said from before, always follow your gut feeling. If you stay true to the music will stay true to you. You know what I mean?
Ooh, I like that.
Yeah.
I have to let you know that I like the song a lot, Shape Shift.
Shapeshift.
It sounds like that was written for the people, you know?
Yes, it is.
When you listen to the words. And I like Finding My Way a lot. Very soulful.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, remind me a little D'Angelo in there with the singing going on. But I know you're going to play us a song right now. And before you get going, I just want to let everybody know, I dedicate this song that Marcus is going to play, Mr. Marcus Machado, to my dear mother who supports me all the time. She's my biggest fan, my number one supporter, and I love her so much. I stress her out all the time. For good reasons, but I just love her so much. So I hope you playing a awesome song here, because you're playing it for an awesome lady.
Yeah, shout out to mom. Shout out to moms.
Marcus, would you like me to play backup?
Yeah, if you can. Just wait after though. No, I'm messing with you.
I don't get the sound.
We gotta record though first, you know. I got you. No, but this song I'm going to do is off from Aquarius Purple. This one is called Tomorrow Never Knows. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Wow.
Thank you.
Beautiful. Ooh. Yes, those. Ooh.
Shout out to
all that low tones. I like that. You don't want me to get on it, I'm telling you.
Thank you.
You should have seen me in college in front of my friends playing the air guitar to Led Zeppelin, baby. Yeah.
That's what's up. No, thank you.
That was so very nice. You know, I just wanted to bring you on today. You're such a good musician and seem like a great guy. And, you know, I want people like you to have the spotlight on you. You know, you're really making me think, instead of worried about rapping, I really should have spent more time on my instruments, because, I don't know, it seems like a better route than being, you know, and hip hop with all those different things they do to sell out and stuff. I really wish I would have did something like you're doing. It's really cool to me.
No, thank you. No, and like I said, I mean, even in the hip hop world, you know, I think now people are kind of opening their ears up more, you know, but, you know, you just got to find your niche. You know what I mean? Like for me, I would say that it took time, but, you know, as long as it's happened organically, that's the best thing, because I'd rather it happen organically than happen fast, because I could have blown up and been all this stuff and be burnt out at the same time. You know what I mean? So for me, I feel like as long as you stay to whatever it is that you're doing, if it's rapping, playing ball, music or whatever, just give your all into it and everything will, you know, find its way. You know what I mean? I feel like now we got so many different opportunities to brand ourselves as creatives, you know what I mean? It's like, man, we can do Flamingo Electric right now and put it on
SoundCloud.
We can put it on SoundCloud right now and somebody gonna listen to it, you know what I mean? So,
you know, Marcus, baby, thank you so much. You're such a cute guy. Look at you. Mwah, mwah, mwah. Do you have any final words, sweetheart?
Nah, thank you. I appreciate it. Thank you for having me. Much love for everybody watching out there. You can follow me at official, www.officialmarcusmachado.com. The same on IG. And, yeah, just be on the lookout for more stuff. And, yeah, talk to you soon. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, support him and listen to his music on Spotify. That's where I listen to it at. But just find it. Type his name in. You know what to do. Marcus, yeah. Baby, please stay in touch. You continue to do well.
Will do. Appreciate you. Thank you.
All right. No problem.
Take care.
Bye-bye. See you guys next time. I see you tomorrow. I have Nuri Muhammad. You don't want to miss.